Amy Myers Jaffe is a senior fellow at the Council on Foreign Relations, and we're so happy to have her here at our conference at Resources for the Future. Amy, thanks for joining me.
Oh, it's great to be here.
So, Amy, we're going to talk about some of the work that you're doing on advanced technologies in the energy sector, climate change, and geopolitics. But before that, can you tell us a little bit about how you got interested in energy and the environment in the first place?
So my first political action as a citizen came when I was a child. My mother used to bring my brother and I down to this beautiful pond near the house where I grew up. It was part of a complex off of a wetland off of a beach. And a real estate developer decided that they wanted to cement it in and make it a condo. And my mother, our town, I grew up in a very small town, had a town meeting format for its political ruling, governance. And so my mother realized that if she got a certain number of signatures, we could try to block this condo from being built, and we could designate this wetlands as a permanent wildlife refuge that it could not be built on. And so she took me around. We went door to door to get these signatures. And then I came with her to the town meeting and sat in the bleachers while she made an impassioned speech for what a beautiful landmark this pond was and how this was what made the town an important place. And it was an important ecosystem for birds and butterflies and other kinds of animals. And she was successful. And that pond and that beach are still there today, and they're really just a beautiful part of what makes the town where I grew up very special. So that was sort of my first introduction to the idea that we have to take action to protect the environment, and we can take action as citizens in the political process. Fast forward, I'm in middle school, and my father was the one who used to drop me off to school, and now we hit the 1973 oil crisis, and we're having to only be able to buy gasoline on certain days of the week. And my father commuted to work, and so we have to go to the one gasoline station in the town. We have to get in line at like 5 o'clock in the morning to get our gasoline, so we'll have the gasoline for the week. And I think that, I joke with people, it made such a big impression on me that I focused on, even as a high schooler, I entered a term paper contest on the history of the 1973 oil crisis. And I joke with people, I have not moved from that topic, you know, since then. Continue to write about it. I think we're kind of finally moving to a different place globally in terms of geopolitics. But it's very interesting to have that perspective of, you know, having actually sat in a gasoline line and started to think about this problem, you know, really as a young person, and thinking about, you know, what is it that the United States needs to do so that it is not vulnerable to these kinds of disruptions and regular people like my parents are not having their economics or their life turn upside down by something that happens in a very distant place.
And that ties right into the research that you're working on now that we're going to talk about, looking at energy and geopolitics at a global scale. So can you tell us a little bit about the backdrop or motivation behind this recent work on looking at new technologies in the energy sector and what that means for geopolitics going forward?
Well, you know, we're going to have a huge swatch of new technologies, innovative technologies that are going to come from sort of the digital world. So that's everything from self-driving vehicles to, you know, automation programs. You know, when you order a package from Amazon or it's being delivered by UPS, that's all computerized today. There's not a driver who's driving around with packages, making his own decisions about where to drop off first, second. You know, it's all computerized, and the vehicle goes exactly on a route. That's how they can tell you your package is coming at 2:13 because it's all, you know, GPSed. And all of those things affect how we use energy. And of course, the digital world is providing new technologies to produce energy across the whole gamut. So we're seeing a renaissance in oil and gas production in the United States, which was, you know, very unexpected. When analysts were looking at this 10 or 15 years ago, we're seeing real advances in the materials and the costs we can have for doing solar. I think we're going to have the next range of breakthrough is going to be in battery technology, and then we're going to have software, which we already kind of have today, where I could have a solar panel on my home and there could be a problem at the grid level, and my software can turn my house off of the grid so I don't get interfered with, and I can have electricity from my own home system. And that's, I don't have to do anything, I don't have to push any buttons, it's all automated. So there's so many opportunities that are coming that could really make a positive impact. But one of the things I felt needed to be studied is, what's the regulatory framework? Because just letting some tech billionaire make this decision for how we're going to deploy these products. Now when we look at social media, we can understand there were unintended consequences, and there could be unintended consequences in energy and greenhouse gas emissions as well from these technologies. So we really need to go into it with our eyes wide open.
And so when we think about these evolving technologies on an international scale, is there a race, so to speak, to be the next energy powerhouse when it comes to developing specific technologies? And if there is a race, who are some of the players involved and what kind of strategies are they pursuing?
Well, you know, there's definitely a race. And I think if you listen to the sort of political leaders today, you can hear it a little bit in our discussion towards the trade war with China. Because some of the technologies that we're concerned with, not letting China dominate in or not letting them buy companies in the United States, have to do with these technologies like artificial intelligence and LiDAR, which is an enabling technology for automated vehicles. You know, China has made a big push, it's called China 2025, to really be the leading player in batteries, in electric cars, in automation for vehicles and robotics, in energy. You know, this combination of batteries and renewable energy, both at the utility scale and at the household level, is going to be a very important industry, you know, going forward. It doesn't look like it's here and now right today, but, you know, looking down the road, these are going to be very important technologies. And I do think you're going to have a very competitive race between the United States and China.
Turning to the issue of climate change and how that fits into this discussion about technologies, if we're looking towards a future where deep decarbonization occurs, which is something that's still uncertain at this point, but if we do move towards that future, how could a world where hydrocarbons are less important to the global economy affect the United States and its relationship with certain major producing nations, countries that we've been historical allies with, such as Saudi Arabia, or countries where we've had more fraught relationships, such as maybe Russia or Venezuela?
Well, I think we're already seeing that today, because in the past, if we had tensions with Russia over, you know, whatever it was, the Ukraine or other activities in Europe, or, you know, now we have to worry about this interference in U.S. elections, we were a little bit constrained by Russia's dominant place in the world as an oil producer and as a natural gas supplier to Europe. And same with Saudi Arabia and the countries from the Middle East. So today, already, as we see these digital technologies coming and we know what we could do with those technologies, combined with the fact that we're using those technologies to have a huge upsurge in the amount of oil and gas that's available here in the United States for use here in the United States. And we're moving towards becoming a net exporter of oil and refined products. So that's really changed the dynamic. And I think you can already see it in the landscape. You can see it in how we debate foreign policy towards Venezuela. You can see it today in how we debate foreign policy towards Saudi Arabia. If you compare how people talked about Saudi tensions in the Saudi relationship in 2001 to today, you hear a lot more talk in Washington, D.C. about whether the Saudis are truly a valuable ally or not. I think that part of the freedom of being able to even debate that comes from this changed landscape in energy. And as we move forward, there are going to be more consequences in the sense that energy-producing countries were used to having that as a leverage or as an offering to make themselves important. And as that no longer has the same salience, we have to worry about more erratic behavior and different kinds of foreign policy orientations from those countries too, as energy becomes less of a dominant feature of their foreign policy. So it's a mixed bag. I mean, it could actually make the world, you know, we always think of it, oh, if we could just have energy security and diversify away from these oil producers, we could have a much more stable world order. And that's, you know, sort of a view, but you could almost argue it the opposite way, which is that as those countries, you know, struggle to find their place in the world and reorient themselves to being less influential on an energy basis, then we have to worry about, you know, how do we integrate them into a different kind of global world that's moving into transition.
Right. It could even exacerbate volatility and unpredictability in some of these countries.
Well, I mean, I think if you look, for example, at Russia, right? So Russia had this foreign policy after the fall of the Soviet Union. There was this orientation towards having energy be sort of a geopolitical tool. And that could be a positive thing where they're, you know, trying to, you know, forge a relationship, or it could be a negative thing where they're trying to use it as a lever, geopolitical lever. And as we've moved away from that vulnerability, because we have U.S. natural gas that can be exported to Europe, we've got a lot of new finds for natural gas in other places that could also be exported to Europe, and we're probably moving into a very abundant natural gas world globally with the liquefied natural gas that can be put in ships or, you know, new pipelines. Russia's leverage over Europe for natural gas and their plans to be a major exporter to Asia have become challenged, really challenged. And I would argue that that has led to a more erratic Russian foreign policy and a more aggressive Russian foreign policy. And so we do have to think through, you know, how is the world going to evolve as we move to these different technologies, and our energy system's going to be more complex, so no one particular fuel is going to dominate. So on a geopolitical basis, if all you had to do as the U.S. president is pick up the bat phone and call the king of Saudi Arabia and you could stabilize the oil market, that's a pretty easy, uncomplex transaction. If we're having energy, we're having electricity go into our automobiles, go into maybe trucks someday. We're going to have automation. We're going to have all these other different things. That's going to make the supply chain much more complex. There isn't going to be one country we can call and say, hey, there's an oil supply problem over here. Can you help us fix it? Right? This is going to be a major complex energy system where you have different players that are important to different markets, and it's going to be more complicated in terms of managing not only the geopolitics of it, but keeping all the supply chains of everything you need to manage this more complex energy system secure.
Turning towards Asia, one of the huge stories in energy over the last 10 years and increasing over the coming decades is the rise of Asia as an energy consumer, and energy demand largely shifting from the so-called West to what we might think of as the East. So how does that shift in global demand moving to Asia and China in particular, how does that affect energy geopolitics in the context of efforts to deal with global climate change?
When the Obama administration wanted to make an initiative to reposition the United States to take a leadership role towards the Paris Accords, they focused on China. You know, let's get an agreement between the United States and China, and we'll work out from that. And that was a big change because in the past, Europe has been a big leader, and Japan and some other industrial countries, on having a climate change initiative. But everybody considered China to be a key player because their economy is growing, and it's going to be such a big economy, and they're a big user of fossil fuels, both coal and oil, and growing. And so there was a thought that if we're going to tackle global warming, you know, first stop China, second stop India. And I think that's still true today. Now, the interesting thing, you know, with the United States abdicating a leadership position on climate change, it's created this opportunity for China to take a leadership position. And that's happened in a couple of different ways. Number one, they have a huge policy to lead in clean energy. So to the extent that countries do want to pivot and decarbonize, you know, China is trying to position itself to be the main supplier of all the technologies and products it would take to do that. The second thing is China has this initiative called the Belt and Road. So under Belt and Road, right now, there's been some questions about whether or not the infrastructure that China is financing or supplying or building in its neighborhood is actually climate friendly. China's Belt and Road benefits from the UN's effort to take money from the industrial West, so this $100 billion commitment to help the developing world, to the extent that China's going to go in with that same capital and bring in energy projects and infrastructure projects and port projects and so forth, you know, they could be a dominant player in that movement. And so even the Trump administration, which has not been a climate-friendly administration, realized that they had to create a new agency in the United States to do international infrastructure lending and projects. And, you know, one hopes that since that organization now exists, that it can channel into the global climate initiative.
Well, Amy Myers Jaffe, we could sit here and I could ask you a million questions about these topics because there are a million issues to explore. But we're out of time, so thank you so much for joining us, and looking forward to seeing the work that you have coming forward.
Thank you very much for having me.